the NISA Game of the Week, and we welcome you to week two of the NISA regular season. Plenty of highlights on attack and on defense, keeping fans on the edge of their seats, all leading up to the championship on July 3rd. A lot of soccer to look forward to. We're at Irvine, California, Championship Stadium at Great Park, as the LA Force take on 1904 FC. Welcome in, everybody. I'm Trey Bender alongside Devin Kerr. Glad you're with us for the LA Force in adjustment period, now without their injured star, Chandler Hoffman. 1904 FC, a great showing in Chattanooga.
And to be fair, both of these teams found some success, Trey, right? Of course, LA Force had an opportunity in that final match to get into one of those semifinal spots that didn't take shape, but there were some quality performances for them. 1904, on the other hand, they did get in. If it wasn't for Stephen Carroll's brilliance from Detroit City, maybe we would have seen them against Chattanooga. But let's go back to LA Force for a second. What do they do now in that striker position with the absence of Chandler Hoffman? Chandler Hoffman going down with injury, but he was brilliant before it. You know, a guy who was coming back from an ACL injury, 3 goals in 2 games, and he did it in very different styles. The through balls we know about, the tight-knit spaces was better. He was good in the air. He was good in runs and support. Unfortunately, that would all change in their final match when he came in. Again, could have been the Golden Boot Award, but this run to the near post sealed his fate. They will be without his presence up top. It's going to be trial by fire right now in that attacking position as they move forward.
On the 1904 FC side, what did they do well at that NISA tournament in Chattanooga?
And for them, Trey, here's what it came down to. They established an identity. Slow start, got faster. Then they knew that they were going to play in this 3-4-3 box in the middle, but so did Detroit City. They never evolved from that, so it was very easy to break them down. In order for them to have success moving forward in this spring league, they have to find a way to start to change their shape because opponents know how they're going to line up.
Lineups coming up next from Irvine, California. The LA Force and 1904 FC next. You're looking at Championship Stadium at Great Park in Irvine. The LA Force and 1904 FC ready to square off. Let's take a look at the LA Force lineup brought to you by Zara.
Not a lot of changes to Talas Peterson since the last time we saw LA Force doing battle. The key thing you want to keep an eye on is this front three and four and what it's going to look like moving forward in the absence of Chandler Hoffman, which we just talked about. Christopher Rivette, Eric Hernandez, Keegan, as they call him, are going to have to step up, but it's going to be the playmaker, Christian Gordillo-Marino, down in the pocket that's going to allow this team to explode going forward. Talking with Chandler Hoffman prior to that fateful match, he talked about just not necessarily having the rhythm from their number 10, but if they can get this guy going down in the engine room, that is where all their success is going to lie moving forward, Trey.
1904 FC, their lineup brought to you by Level Up.
And I talked about their shape, how they like to box this midfield. I know it. Other teams know it too. They're very efficient within the system. The problem is they're going to have to step outside of their comfort zone to have success. You do see a few changes. You could see some movement off of this as well, as Lara can shift to right or left. Ariola, of course, can do the same thing. But down in the engine room, Klazuski alongside Elmu Baslot, that box has to twist, it has to turn. But keep an eye on the right side of the midfield. Ash Apollon, he's a guy who was recently brought in under the tutelage of Mark Briggs of Sacramento Republic in 2020. He's a guy who flies on the outside. He can cut inside, cut outside. Getting him down into the channel and finding those square balls across, he has such great explosion. They have to find a way to catch him in transition.
Can the new face for this club get things done? Kickoff is next. LA Force, 1904 FC from Irvine. LA Force and 1904 FC on a beautiful evening for soccer in Irvine. The LA Force keys brought to you by Contact, their head coach, Talas Peterson. Majority of his team is new, and they've been practicing in Irvine, familiar with the field and the atmosphere. And here's our national anthem. Our national anthem, Talas Peterson, his team wearing the dark uniform. They're the home team here playing in Irvine as we look at the keys brought to you by Contact.
And again, we have alluded to this already, Trey, but the next man up, because it's not just the playmaking ability of Christian Gordillo-Marino down in the number 10. It's not just Eric Hernandez and Christopher Rivette, Diego Barrera, Di Maria Aliwine, Villon in the midfield, the overlapping runs by Osegueda and Villatoro. They all have to get involved because it's not going to be one specific player to fill the role of Chandler Hoffman. Everybody has to help moving forward.
1904 FC, after a good showing in Chattanooga. Scott Morrison, he did not make the trip due to COVID. Here are their keys brought to you by Level Up.
I say box to box because it's a big phrase that everybody likes to talk about midfielders. And yes, this midfield does need to go box to box, but they did that in the Legends Cup. What I mean by here is let's tweak that box. You want to turn it into a rhombus. Someone step outside. Let's get a triangular shape out of it. You could play tic-tac-toe, Trey, I don't care. But they need to start adjusting their views moving forward and defensively, because as good as they were in preparation for all of those matches moving forward, Detroit City knew exactly what was coming at them. LA Force were no the same. So the playmakers and defensive midfielders have to start to tweak how this looks if they want to be successful.
Throw a little geometry in there. I like the rhombus. And hey, if it works, go with it. They'll have to figure out a way. They're not going to replace Chandler Hoffman, but they have some capable people that can step up and help them. The goal for LA, keep the game tight. Don't let them enjoy possession for too long. And we've seen 1904 FC win the possession battle.
And that's the other thing for LA Force is, as the tournament went on, you know, they struggled defensively, they struggled offensively. You know, you reach that final consolation match, and their best defense is their offense because they stretch the field and everybody moves together. As they drop down in, they sit in a good quality block, and then they can pick and choose their moments going forward. And as we've mentioned, they're just going to have to do it without their number nine.
1904 FC, the first club to join NISA. Scott Morrison, their head coach, originally from Scotland, the director of the San Diego Surf Soccer Club. And we are underway here on a beautiful evening, temperature in the 60s in Southern California. Shouldn't be any concerns with heat playing at night. And the weather's usually pretty good in this part of the country. Eric Villatoro to Daniel Clem, who plays it back to the keeper, Brandon Gomez, back from a wrist injury. He was their starter last year as the goalkeeper. Wearing the highlighter yellow. You like that look? Stands out.
Big fan of the highlighter. Yeah, and you know, I know, Trey, you and your heart as a play-by-play guy, it holds a special moment because you get to have fun picking out the numbers, right?
I don't even need a number with that guy.
That's right. Well, it's the goalkeeper, so you get a little lucky. I do like it, though. It's very Borussia Dortmund, late 90s. Big fan.
Yep, I like it. He's from Southgate, California. A lot of California kids on the LA Force roster. And they had some moments. They beat New Amsterdam FC in Chattanooga 3-2. That was a game Hoffman had a couple goals. Lost to Michigan Stars 2-0 in their last outing. The Hoffman injury, so unfortunate in the first half of that one.
Eric, you're too far. Turn.
See the sun creeping through there. Kind of reminds you of the old Texas Stadium where the Cowboys used to play. You'll have shaded areas and sunny areas. Misha Marson, the keeper for 1904 FC. He's gone all the way as their goalkeeper this season, both at the NISA Legends Cup and now in the regular season, number 16. Young team, their average age 22.
Yeah.
referee Omid Azadpour. As Diego Barrera goes down, a key piece for the LA Force side. And a first free kick opportunity. See that sun shining through, Devin, as they line up the wall.
Well, the problem is it goes from the sun into the shadows and then back out. It's really difficult for a goalkeeper to track in a situation like this. You want a challenge. Obviously, good service is key, but just give an opportunity to flick it through.
And a one hopper, and Marson has it. Some traffic in front of him.
It's really difficult to track, and you know, as the match goes on, of course, you're going to lose that opportunity because of the fact the sun's going to start to set. So something to think about, these long balls up over the top for LA Forest, Talis Peterson. Challenge these guys because the same's going to go for the defenders as well. Coming out of the shadows, looking up over your right shoulder.
We touched on the adjustments the LA Force have to make without Chandler Hoffman, and you know, easier said than done. You know, the goal at the start of the season, when we talk to Talis Peterson, our goal, get the ball on the ground to Chandler, and that was their number one priority. Now you got to rethink things. It could open up some interesting people stepping forward. Some new stars maybe could arise.
I make the argument that it presents a challenge, but a good one at that, Trey, in the sense that you're not necessarily so one-dimensional in that spot. 100%, you're losing a lot of talent, and we all understand that. But the counter-argument to that is not having that one, you're not so predictable moving forward. It's not going to be those balls through on the back line to find your out-and-out number one striker.
Areola with a cross, a good one, cleared out of there.
You know, you can ask a little bit more out of Godia Mourinho. You know, Eric Kinkin Hernandez up over the ball right now. He can drop down in like he does, and he doesn't have to play such a high line, and so that everybody starts to move. It's very difficult. You're not looking at one now. It's three and four pieces that aren't just moving into enemy territory. Each and every time they step on the ball, they're doing it from different angles and in different positions. And as a center back, an outside back, it's hard to track those runners when you're so accustomed to peeking over your left shoulder and one player being there, and all of a sudden it's two, or they've moved to the other side. Takes some really impressive communication to have some top-notch defending.
Hernandez, a guy, according to his coach, that can unlock a defense. A lot to learn, but very creative. We've already seen some magic on this field from Chile Araneda, and an interesting connection that you found out with Eric Hernandez.
It's funny how the youth of the nation unite as one in such a small world, right? The footballing universe is the biggest small world that you will ever know, and sometimes unless you're intertwined in it, you really don't follow it. Had the opportunity to pick the brain of Chile Araneda's father, reached out and he talked about how Eric Hernandez and Kikin, as he goes by in Chile, they've actually known each other and have been lifelong friends, traveled together for the past 2 years, best friends, as he put it. And I love how he said that, funny because they're roommates and rivals. They actually live together and have for the past 2 years. And even through their trials over in Spain, an opportunity to train together. Night before a big match tonight where Eric Hernandez knew he was going to be able to get that start. Come on, buddy, go have a little pregame dinner, a little sushi. Nice to see each other supporting one another in situations such as so. Of course, Chile Araneda, the standout for Cal United, who had himself a career day last time out.
Fantastic story there. Ozzie Ramos now with a free kick opportunity as Ash Apollone was knocked to the turf. Let's see if they can make something of it here. The captain. Hey,
Felipe Laborio. Here's Areola. Far post. Skips through. Shot. And it's off the mark, off target there. Areola got it started.
Now, Mubasalat a little surprised that he doesn't get this on frame because he's got daylight in front of him for sure. Right at the penalty mark. No pressure whatsoever, and yet somehow skims all the way to the back post. Good on 1904 to be able to get a second chance through it. Those are the little moments, you know, lacking that offensive firepower for the Belgian Cup that's got to get better this time around.
Apollone trying to cross it, top of the box, cleared out. FC tied the Michigan Stars in their first game in Chattanooga, beat Maryland 2-1, and lost to a fantastic Detroit City FC team. Detroit City FC winning again today, 1-0. They have yet to be scored on in the NISA Legends Cup or during the regular season.
Just rude by Trevor James. I mean, he's got quality game plans every time that team steps on the pitch, and you know, it can get a bit boring at times, to be honest. But that's not the end of the world at all. You know, they have a style, an identity, where they can go and, you know, nick one goal on one end of the field, and they'll play defensive for, you know, 60-plus minutes if need be. You know, if you want to step out and give them a window to work with, they'll take it, but they're not going to force the issue. Very quality on the ball from start to finish, Detroit City FC.
And one chip forward, Garduño. And a grab there, possession to the LA Force. Having practiced on this field, familiar with the surroundings, doesn't hurt at all for this team from Los Angeles. Depending on traffic, not a bad drive to this area, and a lot of players spread out all over the LA Metroplex in Orange County. Played back to the back line. FC on hiatus last year due to COVID-19, their first season. A lot of excitement in San Diego. Great soccer community down there. Demba Ba, the owner and chairman. Apollone. Shot with the left foot. Didn't get all that one. Ramos. Marson coming out of there.
That's aggressive from Misha Marson coming all the way off the line. Just think a center back could easily just knock this one back. And 1904 have tweaked their shape here, Trey. It's a different look for sure. It's not that flat out three that we saw where Lara Stoop, Dallin Cutler last time out were pretty traditional in their ways. Talked about boxing the middle and how that needed to change, but what they've done is as you tweak the back line, you're already going to make your opposition start to move out of their customary areas that they were looking to attack with Mazewski on that right side, you know, playing a wingback style role. And, you know, it's not sitting five either. They're just kind of fluctuating side to side. Overload on the left with Areola and Garduño working off each other. Apollon has actually moved to the midfield, and they've got him dropping down in. And so you still acquire a similar shape, but this is the tweak that I talked about, where you have to find a way to be inventive, right? And so they pretty much sat three, box four, and then three. They're still giving themselves the opportunity to do that, but instead of showing the traditional way that they did in the Legends Cup, now they're having guys move. Little pinch here, tuck up top, rotate to the right. So they carry the bases that were in before, but they're making LA Force think.
There you see the book on 1904 FC. Youngest in NISA at 22. And creative with the 19th and fourth letters of the alphabet. Tip of the cap to San Diego. This is week two of the regular season, and we have had every game of the regular season so far end in a 1-0 final. The first four, so goalkeeping, defense have been good. Here's an opportunity now, and a missed opportunity for Garduño.
He wondered as to whether or not this was a foul coming through, Trey. You get a better look as Daniel Clem gets away with one. No harm, no foul there. Well, it's got to be better from Garduño, though. He knows it, too.
You try to get out a couple of feet before you hit that first. Yeah. Rubet on that far sideline. Kind of needle that one through there. Amu Vaslet was at the point of the attack.
Well, the argument from the sideline is, and you could hear it a little bit from the coaching staff, they were asking Ozzy Ramos to keep it a bit more, and I can't blame him. The midfield almost playing too quick here. Now, obviously, you want to move the process along, but sometimes you just need to usher this side to side and start to move the opposition out of position. And instead, they're trying to go vertical real quick, and they don't have their numbers set. So what's happening is, as Garduño's moving, or Apollon is stuck in the middle, they don't have that point man up top. They go to look to play the ball, and sometimes they're just playing it in hopes. And it's really easy for LA Force to pick up possession.
Ramos trying to play it to the middle, intercepted. Gordia Moreno. Here's Hernandez trying to track it down. And that stays in. He's trying to turn the corner there. They keep it in though. Villatoro. Barrera. Deflected. So big on possession, good lead up here. Apollon, here's Areola, the cross, and he had Amu Vaslet running towards that far post.
Get the way! Grandor! Oh, maybe four! Make sure you keep Dan with the line.
Ariola really good on the left side. That foot. Trying to connect with Laborio, intercepted. Play forward. Hernandez running right, left out in front, and a good play defensively. And shaken up is Edwin Lara. He did a great job to get back to the box.
Much better in buildup here, though, from LA Force, Trey. And we talked about the distribution going forward. Gordillo Mourinho had actually rotated to the left. And then as this thing develops up top, 1904 gets caught off guard. That back three had been spread out. Lara, you could see him stepping back in right in the beginning of your picture. And then Dallin Cutler on the right-hand side doesn't catch the runner right through. It's a great step up through the middle by Christopher Rebet, just a bit offside. But that's what you need. I said it wasn't going to be one guy for LA Force. He drops over to the left and then explodes moving forward. Just has to time it a bit better.
Alleywine challenging there. Good connection, but passed Amu Baslett.
There.
20 minutes in here. NISA regular season play week two. The LA Force and 1904 FC both coming off good showings in Chattanooga at the NISA Legends Cup. LA playing without Chandler Hoffman. He was injured and they're trying to adjust, find some new stars against a possession-oriented team in 1904 FC.
Play. Just play.
There's a view that would be interesting. They high the view from up top from the balloon. Let's get
more
some interesting
games
perspectives.
In the giant peach, no?
Yeah.
Than orange.
You could see
would
formation
you go up there?
Very well from up there, Devin.
Yeah, would you go up there?
I don't think I would. I would stay down low, and I would send you up there, though. All right, I'd actually ask our producer if he'd want you up there.
There you go.
You'd have
a little
to ask
parachute.
Kevin.
Send me on my way.
You break down the game from a different angle.
Sure, that's exactly what NISA wants. They want analysis breakdown and base jumping at the same point in time. We'll work that in next year.
Gordillo Mourinho, he's the playmaker. He can dictate the rhythm of the game. Barrera leaves it in the corner. And that's off the mark. Vietoro.
They're getting more creative, though. You know, Diego Barrera starting on the left, coming all the way to the inside. And as Gordillo Mourinho starts to unload some of those duties, you know, this front four is starting to find a bit more rhythm. Kikin struggling with a little bit on the width, but he's understanding that it doesn't have to be all him. You know, if that movement starts to come to the near touchline and he's already stuck inside, allow the run on the outside to develop.
Here's his corner. Through the box, Garduño. Ahead, Amu Baslett. Good challenge there.
It's a pretty impressive challenge by Seamus McLaughlin just a second ago as Chapelon was just bursting through the middle. Caught out of shape. Not for the first time in the opening 23 minutes, LA Force. They have struggled a little bit. The communication between McLaughlin and Daniel Clem. Constant reinforcement coming from the sideline by Talis Peterson and coaching staff, asking Seamus to keep everybody on the same page. And if you notice, when 1904 starts to move vertical, that back line is not lined up in one flat line. They're kind of staggered, and what that provides is these tiny little seams for San Diego to play through. They've only found it through twice. And fortunately enough for LA Force, they've been able to recover. But if they can pick that up, put a bit more pace on the ball, and find the speed of Ash, that's a good move for them.
Talis from Sao Paulo, Brazil. Here's Diego Barrera with a 1904 FC player down. That's Apollone. New face getting the start at a forward position. Familiar in soccer circles, but for 1904 FC, a fresh face out there.
Yeah, you know, 30 years of age, right around that area, and international experience, considering the fact that, of course, it's with domestic teams, but Thailand, Kitsap Pumas, Vietnam, a couple teams in France. They actually found him via an open tryout at Sacramento Republic in 2020, and interestingly enough, talking to Mark Briggs about it, head coach of Republic in the USL Championship, he said, you know, the guy just kind of popped out of nowhere, wasn't on our radar, had no clue he was showing up, and almost had to do a double take and go, you sure you belong here? You know, why are you at an open trial? Because he was that good, light years ahead of everybody else that was involved. So that gives you an idea of the kind of talent that the coaching staff recognized, and playing a different role tonight for sure. Accustomed to seeing him out on the wing, a bit more in transitional moments where they utilize that speed, but he has done well on the inside, you know, dropping in. Both he and Garduño just trying to find it at the same point in time, working off each other. Again, this is a process for 1904, who had gotten better every single time out, just ran into the brick wall that was Detroit City because of the fact that they hadn't changed their game plan. But it's taking shape and changing shape right in front of our eyes right now.
They have allowed a single goal in their first three matches, with a tie, a win, and a loss in Chattanooga. Gordia Moreno. Clem pushing up to Barrera.
Trey, just look at all the white jerseys. Look at how low this defensive unit is for 1904. That's another big difference that we're seeing out of Scott Morrison's team. Much more impressive, you know. I loved the shape of the midfield, regardless of the fact that it didn't change. And we knew that the back three and Laura Stoop and Cutler could hold their own. But now the fact that you've got all 11 guys right now crammed in to basically a 35 or 40 yard span, that makes it really difficult for LA Force to break this team down. You're going to have to ask a lot of questions, take some chances as well. The long balls over the top are fine, quick footed movements, but eventually someone like we're seeing from Kikin is going to have to step up and beat a player.
Here's Rebet with a cross. Vion spinning around.
Again, the one-on-one movements. Well done by Kikin, though he doesn't finish off the run. It's a good job by Christopher Rebet just to spin off the back shoulder of Jonathan Stoop. It's difficult for a center back because you've got two runners coming at you. The ball just sprays out. You're not exactly sure if Kikin is going to continue his run. He actually gets tripped up. And then the speed of Rebet on full display down to the byline. Can't find the back post run. But these tiny little moments for LA Force, when the field is that restricted, that's exactly how you're going to succeed.
Here's Apollone showing his athletic ability, trying to weave through a couple defenders. Offsides. Rebet, there's that speed. Well, he can't really run. Showed off there. Edwin Lara. It's kept in. Here's Barrera.
Remember, I mentioned to you, Trey, that regardless of what level, high school, collegiate, professional, that you played at previously, anybody who notches 35 goals at the collegiate level, and of course this was spread out between Long Beach Community College and Hope International Royals and the NAIA, that's exactly what Christopher Rebet did. That's not just a fluke. You know, you can say, oh, well, maybe he's not the greatest in this area or that area, and I'm not making that case right now, but Christopher Rebet obviously has a formula for himself, speed one of them for sure, and his ability to read the space around him. We've already seen that in the opening 30 minutes where he understands that it's going to be these quick movements where sometimes it'll be a touch on his own, sometimes he's going to have to make it playing off of someone else, and as this ball comes through, got to be very quick-witted. You know, the turn, maybe a touch or two, tops, and then he's got to go, and he's got to find those runs too, and his teammates now have to recognize that that option is on, because twice in the last 5 minutes, they've been able to find him head on a swivel in terms of what that back line looks like for 1904. So he's not in the offside position, but as he moves down into the corner right now, where's the support coming from?
Lara, it's kept in. The shot by Barrera is high.
When they get lucky again with Rebet down in the corner, just to flex off here, kicking, trailing. And then a poor giveaway by Edwin Lara coming off that back line. Great job by Diego Barrera to just step in, understands that he's got to lean through this. And the problem is his touch gets out in front of him. As he tries to lean into it, it's so far extended from his body, his natural position starts to lean back and away. And that's why Misha Marcin isn't troubled by it. And it's just up over top of the bar.
This first match after the Chandler Hoffman injury, they're going to learn a lot throughout the course of the season, but it's a chance to see some emerging stars here. You mentioned Rebet. Hernandez could be a guy, but they have to be excited. Obviously, you're not excited about the loss of Hoffman, but...
He touched that. He touched this as his ball.
And the yellow card on the keeper.
Trey, he's really lucky here too, because if you don't have help by Edwin Lara, and this is one-on-one, he gets around him via Toro, because there's the touch right here. Marcin reaches out, there's the touch on the hand, and then watch this, via Toro's in. If Edwin Lara is not there, this could be dogzo, because it's headed towards goal. The difference is you've got two defenders in the area. It's right on the touchline. It's an argument in terms of proximity to goal. But well done by Viatora to apply the pressure on Misha Marcin.
So 32 minutes in. JP Osegueda with the free kick.
Well, he can go short here at the top of the 18 if he wants, if they don't step
Hernandez
out. He's got the space right there.
You can see number 11. He's going to go far post, skips through, shot, and the redirect, and it's turned away. Backline play there. In front of the keeper, here's another look.
Sometimes for the LA Force, you're just gonna wonder, how do I buy a goal here? Because they're crashing the box. Marcin doesn't get all of it. And then watch the run by Dallin Cutler. That's your outside right back. who was standing on the post to begin with, knows exactly where he needs to be, comes all the way back across. Johnny on the spot, putting it politely. Great clearance by Cutler off the back line.
Their most experienced player with one of the gems here in the first half. He did not play in their last game, was injured in Chattanooga. And a highlight play here in the first half in Irvine.
Two pretty questionable decisions by the goalkeeper as well, Trey, where, you know, the one down on the corner against Vietoro reaches out with his hand, and then when he comes off his line here, I don't mind that fact. That is the right move. But if you're going to come two hands punch or one hand and away from danger, instead you send it right back in to where all the LA Force players are and give them a second chance opportunity. Again, great job by Dallin Cutler to recognize the threat and slide across to help the goalkeeper out.
Hernandez near the touch line, tried to connect with Ollywine to no avail. Foul on Barrera. Minutes in, first half here. Play back for Lara. Apollon. Ramos goes left to Liborio. Ariola. Here's a shot by Almu Basla. Tried to bend it in there. And just wide to the right.
That's not a bad movement by 1904, though, because Almu Basla recognizes that he's just going to acquire the vacated space by Ariola that had just cut in from the left side. And you know, they're having some success in the midfield now, Trey, because Vion and Ollywine are chasing so much in transition. They're having trouble holding shape in the midfield underneath Cordillo Marino, Kikin, and Barrera. Rebet had actually moved to the left and up top, and there's almost too much rotation at this point in time because the only one out of that front four for LA Force that's staying traditional is Kikin. You know, number 11 in your picture, right on this right-hand side, matched up against Edwin Lara as we speak. And I don't mind rotation. I said that they need that in order to have success and that everybody needed to be involved. But you also have to have responsibilities. And right now, though moving forward, it's getting better. Defensively, they're struggling. Because as they check in, they're not stepping back. And it makes it that much more difficult for their holding midfielders to not only get the work done defensively, but to be involved in this attack going forward.
Vietoro. Barrera. Here's Hernandez. Over the top, there's Marson coming out of the box again. Put his body on it. Let's be very careful. Not pick up a second yellow, especially when he ventures out of the box, out of his familiar territory. Oh, and there's a challenge. Hard challenge there. As Liborio goes down.
That's a big argument from Diego Barrera and the entire sideline for LA Force. Does he catch him here? I'll tell you what, that looks like a pretty good tackle, and it's not from behind. Looks squared up. And he said, just there, Diego, big tackle, because he does get the ball. The referee from his angle gets caught a little bit, and that's probably the argument you're going to get from your referee right now, is that it's from behind because he's caught right in the center circle. So it looks like Diego Barrera is coming in behind Liborio, but that's not the case. It's a really well-timed challenge from LA Force.
Lara. Garduño plays it to the right side.
Big time, baby. Big time. Good fight. Good fight.
Is this the kind of game you expected, Devin? Scoreless, 39 minutes in. Both defenses had played well heading into this matchup.
I'm not surprised by the scoreless part. I am a little surprised that Villon and Ali Wine in the midfield haven't exactly been overly effective in this movement coming forward. And we said that, you know, losing your number one goal scorer, that everybody else had to find a way to get involved. And that still rings true. And I think they're doing well with those front four. But the problem is, and I talked about this at the top of the broadcast, Trey, if you don't all move together, it becomes this disjointed mess, which is what LA Force has run into. Now, conversely, 1904 aren't exactly having success, but Amu Basalat, Ozzy Ramos, and Liborio Jr. on the ball a lot more, and especially with Ash Apollon dropping down into the midfield. If you watch him right around the center circle right now, he's clogging the midfield. So it's really difficult for Villon and Ali Wine to find any players. As they drop down in, it's just a sea of white shirts. That's the biggest surprise to me, is that LA Force haven't reacted to that. They either haven't dropped an extra midfielder in or spread it out to dance on the ball a little bit more because they want to win that possession battle. You know, they've told us.
Possession percentages, you think they'll be even when we look at the numbers at halftime? In terms of possessing the ball?
It's definitely fluctuated over the course of the first half. I give the edge to 1904 for sure, but they don't even mind that. They don't necessarily need to be on the ball all the time because they're so good in transition like this. Quick fire options moving forward.
Ramos playing it right. And right at the keeper on frame, but an easy play for Gomez. Foul on Liborio. Barrera walking it up. Now plays it forward. Ramos, the captain with it. And that pass off the mark. Trying to stretch the field to the left side. Hear the coaches say, let's set up our run here. Possession for the LA Force, foul on Apollon. You mentioned how they're packing it in. So you go over the top, that's one option. What's your other option? A lot of connections to weave your way through?
That's a couple of different options you can utilize moving forward here, Trey. One is, you know, the tiki-taka style where it's quick movements. Everybody's got to be very active off the ball. What they have seen success in, another option for them is just breaking that line of pressure. You know, the opportunity by Christopher Rabet when he cut down to the end line and brought that ball back across to the far post started because Kikin was willing to go after Edwin Lara. He beat the first player. The second one ended up in a challenge where the ball just popped out quite nicely, I might add, for Christopher Rabet. And the little luck of the draws are one thing, but it's that willingness as a player to take a chance.
Off the set piece, here's Hernandez. Gordillo Moreno sizes it up. Oh, good play there by Gordillo Moreno. Look at that, winning the ball there. And it's going to be a free kick opportunity.
I'm really surprised that Laborio goes studs up just outside the top of the 18 here because they had reset themselves and they were moving away from goal as this ball popped out. But now you could hear it immediately. Everybody knew that Gordillo Moreno was going to step up over this ball. Really dangerous opportunity. But have a conversation here, too, because Marson's been suspect here in the first half. The yellow card in the 32nd minute, had some trouble coming off his line as well in traffic. And it's a great direct shooting opportunity for sure. So don't step off of that. But at the same point in time, with the gray area that has been the goalkeeping position and the area just in front of him, you want to have a chat with your teammates to see if you can pick something else out. But no, this will be right at goal.
Into the wall. Fiatoro, high in the air, and that one hits the top post with the keeper out of frame. They had a shot at it, and then a foul. And a yellow card comes out, and this is on Garduño, I believe. Marson left the goal. And it is a yellow on a Garduño.
Well, this looked like Gordillo Moreno had picked this out. Just outside the top, we just talked about Marson making some incorrect decisions. Here's another one. You have to be real certain if you're gonna come 12 paces off your line that you can win this ball. Unlucky by Gordillo Moreno, who tries to just chip it up over the top. Goalkeeper getting lucky once again. That's going to be a topic of conversation at halftime.
Still a clean sheet, but there's been a lot of drama. And our first half coming to a close here in Irvine, scoreless. The LA Force and 1904 FC. Strange final few minutes there, Devin. Nothing on the board so far. The LA Force and 1904 FC, NISA regular season play. Halftime comes up next. Halftime in Irvine, NISA regular season play. The LA Force and 1904 FC are scoreless. And some heated moments there as they walked off towards the locker rooms, Devin. Seamus McLaughlin
maybe
and
out
others
California.
Had a few words.
It might be out in California, Trey, but that's got Yankee Pot Roast Dinner written all over it. You know, they're just trying to make friends, invite each other over, have a little cup of tea, settle things down. That was a pretty heated first half, having a little fun on the way out of the tunnel.
Well, we talked about 1904 FC and how they have won the possession battle in the past, packing it in defensively. They seem to have frustrated the LA Force so far in this one.
You're just asking more questions, right? You know, the great thing about this game is everybody always says it's chess, not checkers. That's exactly what you're seeing right now, because these two teams got better as the Legends Cup progressed. And now it's time to ask different questions of not only the opposition, but of yourself. 1904, they've tweaked their shape in the midfield. They look different up top. Not as threatening as they'd like to be, but overall, I would say they've actually been the better team as a whole. LA Force, though, they look decent. They look decent moving into the final third. You can see that front three and front four, they're finding these little seams. The problem is the rest of the team on the backside has to follow suit, because it's been much easier for 1904 to go in transition in the other direction.
Both teams played well at the NISA Legends Cup in Chattanooga, trying to carry that momentum into the regular season. Scoreless in halftime. It continues next from Irvine. Halftime in Irvine, California, the LA Force taking on 1904 FC. as an anti-racist organization and a movement towards creating more equitable opportunities and visible change, NISA clubs came together to show unity and purpose. They held an open discussion of current league EDI initiatives with equity committee leadership and paid tribute to Martin Luther King Jr.'s words in pursuit of that dream.
I have a dream that one day every valley shall be exalted. Every hill and mountain shall be made low, the rough places will be made plain, and the crooked places will be made straight, and the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together. This is our hope. This is the faith that I go back to the South with. With this faith, we will be able to hew out of the mountain of despair a stone of hope. With this faith, we will be able to transform the jangling discords of our nation into a beautiful symphony of brotherhood. With this faith, we will be able to work together, to pray together, to struggle together, to go to jail together, to stand up for freedom together, knowing that we will be free one day. This will be the day when all of God's children be able to sing with new meaning, "My country, tears of thee." Sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. From every mountainside, let freedom ring. And if America is to be a great nation, this must become true. So let freedom ring. From the prodigious hilltops of New Hampshire, let freedom ring. From the mighty mountains of New York, let freedom ring. From the heightening Alleghenies of Pennsylvania, let freedom ring. From the snow-capped Rockies of Colorado, let freedom ring. From the curvaceous slopes of California, not only that, let freedom ring. From Stone Mountain of Georgia, let freedom ring. From Lookout Mountain of Tennessee, let freedom ring. From every hill and molehill of Mississippi, from every mountainside, let freedom ring. And when this happens, when we allow freedom ring, when we let it ring from every village and every hamlet, from every state and every city, we will be able to speed up that day when all of God's black men and white men, Jews and Gentiles, Protestants and Catholics, will be able to join hands and sing in the words of the old Negro spiritual. Free at last, free at last. Thank God Almighty, we are free at last.
Halftime in Irvine, the second half right around the corner. LA Force and 1904 FC. Scoreless at halftime, the LA Force and 1904 FC. NISA regular season play from Irvine, California. Championship Stadium at Great Park and a great setting for soccer. Let's take a look at the standings so far in NISA regular season play. And how about Detroit City FC? A couple 1-0 wins. No one has scored on this team either in Chattanooga or during regular season play.
No one told Detroit City they need to start sharing, right? They need to play nicely with others because they're just running away with this thing. You talked about not giving up goals. They've been fantastic offensively as well. And I just mean that in the sense of they get small moments, but they're efficient. They pick and choose their opportunities. And they execute nicely. Remember, this game right now, two out of three teams that had not played a match in spring league yet so far. LA Force 1904 doing battle right now. Stumptown AC rounds that out. They'll get an opportunity soon next week.
We saw Cal United on this field in the last match we broadcast. Very impressive with Chile Araneta striking for a goal in that one. The NISA game of the week, our next five. We'll get to see the LA Force again. They're learning more about their team, and they'll get a Maryland Bobcats team that is very physical in the next matchup.
The Bobcats for sure. There is the Stumptown squad that we talked about. They'll get to host Cal United and Chile Araneta, as good as they were. Darwin Lom, of course, finally get on the act, and Chattanooga will host two out of the final three matches in this spring series that we're going to get. Remember, Chattanooga making it all the way to the final after their glorious start in the Legends Cup, being knocked down by Detroit City FC. And there is the possession battle that I talked about, that 1904 has no problem relinquishing to their opposition because they like to go in transition. They want to be able to overload the movement going forward. They've struggled with the balance, though, Trey, because even though the holding midfielders from LA Force have been caught out, the right side for 1904 is almost non-existent, relying a lot on the left hand with that Areola and the movement of Garduño, Ash Apollon dropping down into the middle. But again, this back line from LA Force has to step up, as do the two holding midfielders. If they can push a higher line, it's going to be more difficult for 1904 to play out.
So we get ready for the start of the second half here. 1904 FC coming off a loss to Detroit City FC, 1-0. They played very well in that game, just ran into a buzzsaw, and that's happened to all the teams that have played Detroit City thus far. The youngest team in NISA, 1904 FC, average age 22. And, you know, they tinker with the starting lineup. In Chattanooga, we saw Lorenzo Ramirez Jr., Cesar Romero, Mo Espinoza. They did not get the start in this one. We'll see if they want to change things up here. It's been Ash Apollon getting the start, the forward position, a new face.
Unless we forget that Mo Espinoza isn't even available for selection, and one of their better playmakers in those three matches we were able to see 1904.
Barrera gets a touch in the box, and a shot, and it's high and away, and it looked like for a moment there Rebet and Hernandez had something cooking. They come up empty.
Let's start with the fact that Rebet doesn't even tuck this thing home. Great ball floated in here by Vion on the back post. And as this thing comes back across, you've got to be better here, Christopher Rebet, and understand exactly where you're situated. Because, yes, he's in an offside position. That's the number one. But number two, you got to put this on frame. I mean, all you have to do is lean on this thing. Just blow on the ball, and it can end up in the back of the net.
You've talked about how skilled Rebet is. He can run like the wind. Missed opportunity there, point blank range.
Five, five.
Here's Dallin Cutler, who played well defensively in the first half. The entry. Let's take a look at Rebet at close distance.
This is more difficult to get wrong than it is to get right. You're like 2.5 yards off the end line. I mean, Trey, if you knock 10 balls into me, I don't know if I would be able to knock 5 over the top. 3, 2, 1. I mean, it's that hard, seriously, counting down by a vowel. It's that difficult to do what he did as opposed to sticking it in the back of the net.
Well, let's see if that comes back to haunt him here. Gomez is there. That highlighter uniform, keeper from Southgate, California.
Well, I'll tell you what's more concerning.
The 2020 season.
What's more concerning, Trey, is the fact that once again he's in an offside position. That's the third one that we've seen from Christopher Rebet. As good as some of the looks we saw from him in the opening 45 minutes, he's got to be better. The positional awareness is definitely lacking in this performance in some really good spots, namely the one from just 2 or 3 yards out, but a couple others in the first half, they could be up 2 or 3 nil if he could just open his eyes a bit better.
Cutler to Laborio. They get it to Apollone. Top of the box, gets it back. Taken down. Apollone creating here. And they're going to have an opportunity just outside that penalty arc there, outside the box.
That's smartly done as well, because as the movement comes through, he knows the challenge is going to come his way. He just sort of eases into this, because one of two things is going to happen. The seas are going to part. That little touch of his is going to burst through the back line, and he's going to stay level and be able to come through and have an opportunity to go after Brandon Gomez. But he also understands that if the presence is going to be felt and he sees the challenge coming, he can lean into it and pick up the foul. And so many quality ball strikers for 1904. Ozzy Ramos standing up over the top. Amu Baslat has hit a few of these. Garduño can go as well.
Ramos, high, just above the bar with that one. You okay with that strike there?
Yeah, I don't mind it at all, to be honest. And for a guy in Brandon Gomez, who most of the things that he had to deal with in the first half were balls up over the top or down to the byline and then cut back across. He hasn't faced anything direct yet, Trey, and so you need to test the goalkeeper, keep him honest. The problem is from that area, you're either gonna score a worldie or it's gonna end up over the top. Very rarely are you able to get enough dip on this to actually drop it in front of the goalkeeper or get it even lower than that top corner. It's so difficult to get up and down in 1904. Another player down. It's not two in the first half.
Got Stoop. Getting up very slowly, Jonathan Stoop. Now back down.
That's not good. That was behind the play and went to ground. And there was minimal contact for sure, but didn't seem like there was necessarily a lot into it. And you go back to the strike for 1904 just moments ago. This is what I was talking about, Trey. It's really hard to get this up and down. Notice his hips closing, coming across. You have to force your momentum to get enough swerve on the ball to move it away from the goalkeeper, but at the same point in time, you've got to hit it with an up pace and yet still get this to drop, catch it right on the valve, bring it back down and allow it to knuckle a little bit. It's dropping for sure. Those are ones that you just stay after training, throw a couple of guys in the box and say, boys, target practice, let's go.
Time, time, time.
Just underway second half. LA Force, a 1904 FC NISA Legends Cup was complete in Chattanooga. This is NISA regular season action. Here's Amu Boslet with two black shirts back there. Apollone knocked down. He's a little bit shaken up. Shot from distance is high and away from Laborio. Substitutions for 1904 FC. Momentarily, and they've been taking a few bumps here throughout the course of this one. Some of the names we saw in Chattanooga look like they're going to make their appearance here as subs in the second half. The next opportunity when they make a couple switches here.
Well, recognize for 1904, Trey, that the last time this team was on the field was that match against Detroit City that was sealed by Stephen Carroll in the second half, and that was all the way back on April 22nd. So quite a bit of time in between then and now, 2 weeks. It was an area where training-wise, they had just started to gel together, and match fitness is very different than what you get in your training sessions. Yes, you're able to keep yourself on par, but it's really difficult to move into the red numbers, and it's exactly what 1904 is trying to do here. And when you make a couple changes as well, you know, you tweak your formation, your mind mentally works different. The wear and tear is much more difficult to handle, and combine that with the fact that you're on the road against an LA Force team that has really challenged you defensively.
Here's Lamelli, who has started the second half. One of the names that we saw in Chattanooga in for Areola. Diego Esquivel is also out there for Andrew Klazuski, who got the start. Far post. And a one-timer, and it's just wide. With the left foot that time, Alma Boslett had a crack at it.
Not a bad strike here from Alba Boslot, and I like the movement by Ash Apollone coming all the way to this right-hand side. Different look for 1904. That long ball back up over the top. As mentioned, you got to try and test this goalkeeper, Trey. Not enough in terms of direct shots on goals and even looks, to be honest, because even the deflections are going to make Brandon Gopez think twice. It's been very easy on the goalkeeper. Just 56 into this match, he has had a lot, to do on that back line.
Garduño with some fancy footwork. Here's Apollone. Laborio. Amu Boslet. Ramos, and a whistle.
And this looks like he just gets knocked on the follow through. Texas deflection as well. Not a bad little strike.
Corner kick opportunity now for Lomeli. Osegueda heading it out of there. Amu Boslet keeps it in. Top of the box. Laborio. And offsides.
Right.
You mentioned not having Mo Espinoza. He's the guy that had the PK goal against the Michigan Stars in Chattanooga. An attacking midfielder, not available tonight. But Esquivel and Lomeli were there as starters.
So was Lorenzo Ramirez.
Yep.
Mo Espinoza was so good in that second game against the Maryland Bobcats. They faltered a little bit down the stretch, ended up being a 2-1 that they had to eke out. But I'd say about 55, 60 minutes of quality performance from Scott Morrison's squad. Even though he wasn't in attendance, he had them prepared. And that's really where we saw this team started to take shape, both literally and figuratively. Midfield was really impressive. Mo Espinoza drifting from the inside to the exterior really gave him the luxury to sort of take chances anywhere on the field. They tried to do the same thing against Detroit City. Good on Trevor James for understanding where that pressure was going to come from. And it is one thing that the frustration by Mo Espinoza started to mount as the game went on. He went ball hunting, and that just was the beginning of the end, because the next thing you know, everything was out of whack, and it was easy enough for Detroit City to just sit back and let the game come to them.
Bosslet keeping it alive momentarily for Esquivel. Holly Wine. Play by Ozzy Ramos over there. Here he is. Strong, so consistent in the midfield. Clem. Ollie Wine, they connect on that right sideline. Oh, and there's a hard challenge right there. And another 1904 FC player down in pain. Yellow card comes out. Garduño hitting the turf. Gordillo Moreno gets the yellow.
He's feeling this one too, as Christian Gordillo Moreno coming through, and just watch that little touch right here on the back side of things when he starts to come back across. Studs out, boot up, and it's right on the follow through. I can't necessarily blame Cody Murillo for trying to win this ball. At the same point in time, that's going to leave a mark for Ivan Garduño, who did a good job trying to play out of the back and move away from pressure.
Ciro de Reyes Oliveira is going to come in now for the LA Force as one of the subs for Alawine, and Edson Alvarado will come in for Hernandez. Make a change in the midfield and at a forward position. Alvarado from Orange County. Here's Cutler.
Time,
You see Alvarado for Hernandez. Looking for a spark, some fresh legs here, and Ramirez will come in. You mentioned him earlier for Apollon.
I was a little surprised that he did not get the start. And of course, Scott Morrison electing to go with what had to be Garduño over the number nine, Lorenzo Ramirez. It was part of that attack that looked so dangerous in the game against the Maryland Bobcats, 2-1 victory in the Legends Cup. Not a bad outing for Chapalon. Thought that the service purpose, yes, it was definitely different than what we had seen out of him in his time at Sacramento Republic. Talked about his exposure in a positive light out on the wing, primarily on the left-hand side, but they brought him to a more central location, asked him to play the point man. Could he hold up in air? Could he drop down in and help out the midfield? The answer was yes to all of them, and yet still here in the 64th minute, they don't have anything to show for it.
Hey, keep it! Ozzy, keep it!
Gomez. And the flag goes up on that far sideline. Approaching 65 minutes gone here in this one. Both teams have had their opportunities. Chris Rebet had one at point blank range. Was offsides, but one you normally put away, but 1904 FC has had their chances as well. And there's a misplay and a shot, and it's turned back by Marson.
That wasn't even a pass. The ball's off of them.
Well, there's an argument coming from the sideline, and I can't necessarily blame them with the deflection coming off here and saying that it's coming off the defender. How difficult is it to pick up the offside call? There's quite a bit of frustration from both coaching staffs, to be fair. It's some of the decisions that have taken shape from our head referee and his crew. Still got a job to do, though.
Cutler to Ramos, squeezes one through, collision. Another guy in white is down. Opportunity now, top of the box, and another player goes down. Lomeli, the latest to hit the turf. Let's take a look at the shot first and the play by the keeper, Marson.
Well, things opening up here, and it starts with 1904 on one side. And as you come back through, watch Misa Marson again. This clearance has got to be better. Lean back. All you have to do is put your laces on it, lean back, and launch this thing down the field. Gordy Marino feeling a bit hard done by the fact that he doesn't put it on frame. And then the transitional move, the challenge, that's a foul there, actually on 1904. They get lucky because the momentum carries through. And then here, really surprised that our referee doesn't show yellow to McLaughlin.
Five-man wall in front. Ramos with the left foot.
Josiah, JP.
Ramos. Good ball there. And it's stopped by Gomez. And the follow is there for the goal. Esquivel, after the miss off the free kick, finds the net.
Well, it's smartly done by Brandon Gomez, and I love the shift that we get out of Daniel Clem. He recognizes they're trying to go to the far post. Brandon Gomez trusts his wall there, cheats on one step, comes back across his body,
plucks this thing out of midair, and as he spills it, just gets no help whatsoever. And look at this angle by Diego Esquivel. He's got nothing to work with. You need a microscope to understand how finite of a space he has to work with. About an inch and a half. All he needs is a millimeter to tuck this thing home.
Precision to give 1904 FC the lead here. Esquivel coming in as a sub in the second half and delivering.
It's just such a small amount of space you have to work with. Timed perfectly. Watch him come. He's moving away from goal. He's got to cut it back across his body. Four players from LA Force tracking on the back post. Brandon Gomez coming back across. And there's no reason whatsoever that ball should have ended up in the back of the net. But credit to Diego Esquivel, because it's a great effort taken perfectly.
FC with Scott Morrison coaching on the field for the first time. Taking the lead here as some subs for the LA Force. Perez will come in for Osegueda. He's been a left back so far this season. He'll replace him there, and Romero in for Rebet.
And they have to do something here to inject some life in this offensive movement going forward. It's been very stagnant in the second half, Trey, and everything that they did well in the first, they faded. That could be energy level, emotion starting to overtake them with the choppiness in the game. But the technical ability still remains for Talas Peterson's guys that he's got on the field, and especially with the fact that he's got fresh legs now. You know, he's made changes at multiple levels for this team. In the midfield, on the back line, and a couple of options up top right now. With the amount of chasing that Edwin Lara, Jonathan Stoop, and Dallin Cutler, and especially Stoop, who picked up that little knock, there's no reason whatsoever you can't apply more pressure on this back three and go after the suspect decision-making by Demisha Marson.
Looks good on paper, Marson. Clean sheet. His team in front. There's the shot. Ambitious. From Esquivel, who's probably still has that adrenaline running through his system. Gave one a ride. To coaches about, and they've said it in different ways, whether it's Rod Underwood at Stumptown, we're going to get 1-3% better every day. You could say that about this 1904 FC club. They have gotten a little bit better. You know, they lost a really good Detroit City FC team, but they've improved, you could argue, each and every time out.
Well, I mentioned that not only have they improved, Trey, and I 100% agree, they've definitely gotten better every time they've stepped onto the pitch. I would make the argument that they have made the biggest progression out of any team in terms of what we saw in that opening match against Michigan Stars to what's playing out in front of us right now. And that's not easy, you know, especially given the fact that, you know, you start from the back and work forward. We haven't exactly seen the best out of Misha Marson, which we've talked about, but there's been some good defending, and it's broken down a lot. But they've been able to recover. And for the lack of defensive shape at certain points in time, it's been a great performance in the midfield. I think they've done a really good job at showcasing themselves in a different light than that four box we talked about, where you basically had two holding midfielders, two attacking midfielders, and that was it. That's not the case this time around. LA Force having trouble tracking all of the runners in white jerseys for Scott Morrison in 1904. And now if they can find a way to get their attacking pieces going, this is a team that should be able to threaten much more efficiently than we've seen over the past 73 minutes. And to be honest, in some of the previous games, they could bag two or three goals a game.
We expect to see Mo Espinoza in the future. Another piece to the puzzle. Won't see him tonight. Alma Boslett keeps it in play. Romelli. And there doesn't seem to be a lot of drop-off. I know they had a different starting unit here, but they don't drop off a lot when they bring in these guys as subs in the second half.
No, but also recognize that the guys that are coming on were the mainstays within that Legends Cup run. So you've got new faces, new tweak in formation, but they all know what their jobs are.
That's headed wide. Stoop was running up on that one with his size.
And you basically had Diego Esquivel on the left, Lorenzo Ramirez Jr. starting in the middle, and then Mo Espinoza on the right-hand side. And again, though that has changed a little bit in terms of the overall aesthetics, they still know what their game plan is. And they've really been able to shut down the midfield play of LA Force here in the second half. I mean, look at the possession battle.
Cordia Moreno. Yeah, 61%.
For a team that's willingly and openly talking about not needing to have the ball all of the time, they are doing a fantastic job at taking one of the strongest suits that LA Force have at their disposal out of reach. You know, this team wants to be on the ball. They want to dictate tempo and dance. And quickly, they are moving away from that.
Diagonal pass to Alma Boslett. Couple players slide down. And that's about half a dozen 1904 FC players that have gone down here in the second half. Ramos, and a yellow card will come out. Barrera and Ramos, and a yellow issue.
And there's the frustration by Diego Barrera, and he's talking about exactly what I was just mentioning, how the midfield, they need more help. He said, we need everybody to step in and apply pressure. And though it doesn't necessarily need to be everybody, they do need more help for sure, because they're overloaded on the interior. Renzo Ramirez playing a much higher long and the focal point, but just look at the movement in between the lines as well. It's a late challenge on it. What you want to look at is the spacing, because there's the four. But as the drop comes down in, that's where the space is occupied all night long. Amu Boslett has come in. Lorenzo Ramirez, Ash Apple steps in front of the back line and behind the two holding midfielders. They pick up and go the other way.
Ramirez Jr. at the point of the attack there. It's punched out. FC tied the Michigan Stars in their first game at the NISA Legends Cup, beat Maryland 2-1, lost to Detroit City 1-0, and now 1-0 lead in their first NISA regular season game. They did some really good things in that loss to Detroit City in the semi-final, couldn't come up with a win. There's a shot deflected out front. They keep it in. And Ramos can't control it. FC's next match will be against Detroit City FC, so we'll get another chance at the champs. Detroit City FC already in the championship. Chattanooga in the semifinal. These teams in NISA in the regular season battling to find out who the other semifinalists will be. At the end of the year, July 3rd, the championship. Having some audio difficulties with Devin's mic. We'll hope to get that fixed soon. Great performance here in the second half from 1904 FC. A goal in the 67th minute from Diego Esquivel. This is a neutral setting, though the LA Force playing as a home team. They have practice here on this turf in Irvine. Familiar with it. Marson sliding to cover that one up. Can this be a, obviously if you can learn things from a win, it's better than learning from a loss. Marson can still come away with a clean sheet, but still some chances here for the LA Force.
Hey, Misha, you had him wide.
And a yellow card comes out. This is on Cutler. And an opportunity for the LA Force.
Good job by the refereeing crew, though, Trey, because he allows the advantage to continue to play on and then understands that immediately it breaks down, comes back to the spot of the foul. You're going to see the challenge occur, and then it comes back across the right side. That is a foul for sure. Gordillo Marino thinking he's going to have an opportunity to pull the strike instead, plays it square. And well done by this crew to recognize that no longer is an advantage able to be played, brings it back to the spot. Dangerous opportunity, a bit further out than we saw 1904 score off their deflection, but still dangerous with two pretty talented ball strikers. And I'm going direct here with Gordillo Marino. The night that Misha Marson's having, this near post, right after it.
It will be number 10. Bends it in there. And possession to 1904 FC, some contact. 80 minutes in. And this would be a great win for this 1904 FC team, the youngest team at NISA, getting a big goal in the second half.
Little things like this, Trey, are always, when you go back and look at the tape, you're gonna regret it. And the reason I say that is 10 minutes to go in a match, where in a second half, you're really struggling to find any sort of rhythm on the offensive side of the ball. LA Force have a prime opportunity to have a strike at goal. At least put it in or around the six to make Marson force himself into a decision, because he hasn't been very good in those decision-making moments that have been pressure-packed tonight. And why you move the ball away from that opportunity, I will never understand. Again, you'll go back, review the tape.
You're saying just at least put the spotlight on him again a few more times.
Challenge him. Pressure. I mean, every single time this ball has been floated in or around the six, he has made some questionable decisions, sometimes giving LA Force a secondary opportunity. So why would you knock a ball up over the top where you've struggled in the air to begin with, but most importantly, Marson on his back line has struggled. Drop this up right around the six, make him come off his line, have someone challenge in. I'm going to have a strike instead, because he's most likely going to spill it up. He's done so with every ball so far tonight.
Here's a free kick opportunity. Ozzy Ramos. Alvarado. Ramos. Hey, Nifty move there from Laborio. Ramos connects with Esquivel, who had the goal. Alex Colwell will come in for Barrera now for the LA Force. Barrera picking up a yellow card in this one. Championship Stadium at Great Park in Irvine, 1904 FC. In the attacking third here, taking their time. Chip top of the box. And that was Laborio, deflected away. So what did they learn from their last matchup with Detroit City, other than that they're a really good club? They're going to get another crack at them in their next game. They'll be a better team heading into that one, but you could argue Detroit City will be better as well.
Detroit City just continues to set the precedent for sure, as Brandon Gomez doing his best Misha Morrison impersonation, playing out of the back. And you know, the key question going to be coming in wasn't whether they could defend or whether they could provide themselves some opportunities in the final third. It was what was the shape going to look like in the midfield. And I keep alluding back to that, Trey, because it's so relevant in terms of how teams set up against them. In that match against Detroit City, and Trevor James recognized that it was going to be a boxed four. And so the way that he started, he just went tit for tat. He had his own four in the midfield as well. That's how they lined up. And as soon as he started to shift, they went with sort of this, you could call it pivoting the box into a diamond type shape. It would also go flat and three with one in front. And when 1904 didn't respond, that's when he knew he owned him, because he had the ability to play in between that box, yet defensively still had the setup. 1904 has gone back, watched it, and said, okay, if a team counteracts us with this, how do then we turn it to that in our favor? And that's what they've done today. You know, no longer is it just two in front of two holding midfielders. They've done a really good job at showing a presence on the wings, starting off with Ariola and Klosiewski in the first half. Diego Esquivel and Romario Lomelli have taken over here in the second. It was more of a triangle type shape, and what they did was two strikers up top, they would drop one in at a time, so you could still get that box type look, but you still had the presence of an overall striker up top. So when you give a multitude of looks, it makes it much more difficult for LA Force to track these runners moving forward.
Here's Amu Boslet now with some space. Makes his move, stumbles, crosses it, top of the box, shot wide. And that was Esquivel looking for a second. Here comes Gordia Moreno in a hurry. Alvarado. Counter. Esquivel. Diego. Double teamed over there. Time running out on the LA Force as we approach the 88th minute. And offsides. Whistle blows.
You got two plus stoppage.
That's like five that they just keep falling or what?
Jonathan Stoop is down. We saw him take a spill earlier in this second half. Very cool conditions in Southern California. This is something else. He is not 100% right now.
He's had his work cut out for him on that back line of Edwin Lara, Alan Cutler, and Jonathan Stoop. They've done a very good job, especially as this game has progressed. Conversely, LA Force has really played themselves out of it on that front line. Changes or not, haven't been able to respond. And still got a couple minutes here, though, Trey.
Here's Romero. For the corner, too far out in front, goal kick coming.
And that's just poor decision making at the tail end of a game when you're tired, because sometimes, Trey, just because you can play a ball doesn't mean you need to play a ball. You know, a pinged ball hit 50 yards from it down into the corner. You've already got to set your position because you don't have a lot of room to get on your horse and chase this thing down in. That ball's got to be spot on into the feet. Otherwise, it's got to be redirected from an area route across immediately, neither of which was an option presenting itself in that moment.
So Rajon Blanchett checks onto the pitch. Jomar Munoz in for Amu Boslet. As we've passed the 90-minute mark here, of added time. The LA Force trying to come up with some magic here. It's been tough sledding most of the way against 1904 FC.
How the fuck is that offside?
Offside's the call as the whistle blows.
Well, one day, probably in the not so near future, someone can explain to me, specifically our referee, how that was offside. Things that make you go, Trey.
Well, we're going to see the LA Force next, Devin, our next NISA game of the week. A team that's learning to play without Chandler Hoffman.
You're wasting your own time. I'm trying to help you.
I have to say that I love the communication from our head referee, because multiple times here with Edson Alvarado, he's been very direct saying, you're wasting your own time, back up. He's not going to add it on for the fact that he's not 10 yards from the ball. And now he's going to card him. He'll eventually end up just saying, listen, I've had enough.
Here comes the, nope, he reached for the card. A few more words for Alvarado.
There you go.
And here, there it is.
Welcome to the party.
waning moments here, added time. 1904 FC on the cusp of getting a win here. The group from San Diego has been impressive in the second half here in Irvine. This will be their second win after beating the Maryland Bobcats in Chattanooga. And that will do it. 1-0, 1904 FC beating the LA Force here in Irvine. Diego Esquivel with a goal in the 67th minute. Great win for this young club.
Well earned on the road, Trey. And as mentioned, coming in, two out of the three teams that had yet to step on the field in this spring season, Stumptown LA Force and 1904. 1904 joining the ranks of Cal United Michigan Stars and getting a victory in their opening game. Everybody, though, still taking Detroit City, who has put together back-to-back wins after their Legends Cup victory.
So week two of the regular season, a victory for 1904 FC over the LA Force, 1-0. We'll be back to wrap it up from Irvine, California. Impressive second half for 1904 FC as they knock off the LA Force 1-0 here in NISA regular season action. Well, it was a goal in the second half from a sub that was the difference. Let's take a look at the highlights.
Everything came down to the set piece opportunity. Ozzy Ramos, Mr. Reliable in the midfield, picks out the upper corner. Brandon Gomez has other ideas, though. Great save by the goalkeeper, who was part of the all-tournament team last fall. The problem is, nobody on the back line helps him out. Great recovery by Esquivel. Drifts over to the left shoulder of Brandon Gomez, tucks this into the bottom corner, and that would be it. 1-0 for 1904, a well-earned victory for a team that fought so hard in that Legends Cup, and they're finally at the top of the table in spring season.
A team getting better and better as we look at the numbers. Look at that possession percentage.
Yeah, right now for me, it is Detroit City. And then the second team overall, 1904. Now, they got a long way to go before they have the opportunity to knock off Detroit City FC. And a couple of teams around them, well, that'll have something to say about it. Cal United, of course. Michigan Stars have gotten better as well. And what can Chattanooga do? But right now, 1904 should really relish this opportunity that has been put in front of them. They knocked it down in astounding fashion. And we'll have to get right back into work as both of these teams, 8 games until we reach that fateful semifinal match in June.
LA Force back to the drawing board, and that will be our next NISA game of the week on Saturday, May 15th. The Maryland Bobcats and the LA Force, 7:30 Eastern time. They'll square off. Thanks to Devin Kerr and producer-director Kevin Shank. I'm Trey Bender saying good night from Irvine, California. Big win for 1904 FC over the LA Force.